Now, today, what Naima tells me is that we have a mixture of audience. We have the postgraduates, the senior consultants, as well as the younger friends from MBBS. So bear with me if I start with a few basics, because people should not feel out of, you know, they should not be bored with what we talk, because the topic is newer developments in quantitative sensing. So I thought it's a good idea to start with what is already available and then go on to the newer developments. So I'll start sharing my slides. Naima, just confirm that you can see the same, huh?
Yes, ma'am. I have made you the host, now you can share it.
Yeah. Is it visible?
Yes.
Okay. So the topic, like I said today, was what's new in contraception? But we start with a few basics.
मैम ठीक है। मतलब कि ज्वाइन कर सकते हैं पढ़ाने के लिए।
So there are a few requirements for the contraceptives. The point is, people go on, you know, so long as the human mankind is, you know, the population increases, there is always the children who are getting born, and then some of them are unwanted. So can I request everybody to mute their mics, please, because I can hear a lot of sound. If others can mute their mics, I request you to mute your mics, please.
Please mute. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So there is a quest on to look for the newer delivery systems, male methods, non-surgical methods, limited side effects, improved cost, biodegradable ones, lengthen the duration of injectables and implants, multi-purpose dual protection against STIs, vaginal spermicides. So there is a dearth of new ideas, and hence, so long as the mankind is increasing in the numbers, there will always be newer developments that are taking place. So like I said, let's go down to the basics first. Naima, can you request everybody to mute their mics, please, if they don't, if not too much of a trouble?
It's a kind request for everyone to please mute yourself, because it is creating disturbance.
Thank you so much. So what are the contraceptive options which are available? Now, you know, there are the ones which are least effective, then there are the ones which are moderately effective, and then there are the ones which are most effective. So what are the ones which are least effective? It starts with the spermicides, go on till the male condoms. So basically, the male condoms, the female condom, withdrawal method, sponge, and the fertility awareness methods. Now, what about the moderately efficacious? That means their failure rate varies anything from 4 to 12 out of 100 women years who are using it. Whereas the condoms and the barrier methods of contraceptives, the failure rates are quite high. So coming to the moderately effective ones, now they could be the female diaphragm, then there are vaginal rings, patches, pills and injectables. Then the ones which are highly efficacious. So these are the implants, intrauterine contraceptive device, and the sterilization methods. So what is happening today is, with this fact that, you know, what have, the basic thing is, there are new developments that are taking place. The basic challenge is the appropriate use of these and the ease of use of these contraceptives, so that the failure rates which are seen typically are also seen in the field at use. So majority of the times this is not the case, because it is dependent on so many factors, including the usage and the user instruction. And hence the newer developments are continuously taking place. So with that premise, this is a brief view of whatever I have already said. So the highest failure rates are for the condoms, the cervical cap and the sponge, followed by 6 to 12 pregnancies per 100 women a year for injections, pills, patches, vaginal rings and the diaphragm. And the least is for the implants, IUDs and the sterilization procedures, less than 1. So coming to the hormonal contraceptives, now every time I start categorizing the hormones, I always remember Dr. Neerja, because this is her favorite. Every time she will talk about the menopausal hormone therapy, she will start with the basics, that is the classification of progestins and estrogen. Progestins could be first generation, second, third, and unclassified. So here there is non-ethindrone, ethinodal. See, what is happening is with the newer developments, the more recent forms of progestogens are getting used. And what is the advantage? There are lesser carbohydrate and lipid side effects that are generally seen with the first generation one. Estrogens could be natural estrogens or synthetic estrogens. Natural is estradiol, estrone, estrone. These are rarely used for contraceptive because of the low potency. The synthetic estrogens are the ones which are getting used for contraception, and these are estradiol valerate and 17-beta-estradiol. Now, a few practice points. Multiphasic pills are most popular because they simulate what is normally happening in the body, the physiology of the hormonal changes that happen, because of which the tolerability increases and also the total dose of the hormones that is delivered to the body is also reduced. The contraceptive efficacy of the newer progestins in the third generation COCs is similar to the older formulations, and the new COCs, like I said, have got lesser effect on carbohydrate and lipid metabolism. So now we quickly go on to the newer contraceptives that are available, and I would be also going on, you know, describing what is available in India. There is something that is available in the world. We should know what is available in our country for translation into practice. So today we have something called the four-phase pill. So this is a combination of estradiol, valerate with dinogest. There is a stepwise reduction in estrogen. Now if you see here, 3 mg, 2 mg, 1 mg. So there is a stepwise decrease in the estrogen, and there is a increase in the dinogest. The way it happens in the body, so starts with 2 mg followed by 3 mg. So it is available in the by the name of Clyra everywhere, all over the world globally, or Natasia. In India, I am not very sure. I think Natasia is available, but Veronica complicate, because the cost is also constrained. It is available at a cost of about 700 rupees. So these are the four phase pills. Then you have the extended cycle regime. You have seasonal and continuous. These are the names of the pills. Seasonal is taken for 84 days. You break for 7 days. 150 micrograms of levonorgestrel with 30 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol. There are fewer periods per cycle. And though there is initial breakthrough burden on spotting, but it is very well tolerated, of especially of great use in endometriosis other than the contraceptive benefit. It has other non-contraceptive benefits too. Continuous use for 365 days, no break, 90 micrograms of levonorgestrel with 20 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol. The breakthrough bleeding is reduced after a use of 8 to 9 months, and the long-term safety of this continuous pills is still under study. Then today, I think most of us, all of us will know about the progestin-only pills, the advantage of not having estrogens in the pills, basically, you know, in the lactating mothers and the ones in whom the estrogens are contraindicated, like hypertensives, the ones who are more, at risk of thromboembolism and so on. So the progestin-only pills could contain either norethisterone, 350 micrograms, or it could be norgestrel and isogestrel or LNG. So I am sure all of us are aware of the progesterone pills which are available in India. So Camilla, Cerazette, you know, then Jolivet, all these are getting used. And we are also aware of the LNGs which are most commonly used for the emergency contraception. Now, a lot of development has taken place in the direction of delivery of the hormone to the body. The biggest problem is people don't want to go on popping pills. And also the problem with popping pills is forgettability. One can easily miss a pill. So the transdermal contraceptive system is something which has been greatly studied. So these are the patches, the gel and the spray. So the transdermal patch is popular Xulane, available in India. It is applied on the buttock, abdomen or in the upper torso. It is important to remember that it has to be away from the breast. So it is 3 weeks on and 1 week off, and replaced every week starting from the first day of the period or the nearest Sunday after the onset of menses, or if it is more than 4 weeks postpartum. So if initiated more than 5 days from the onset of menses, a backup contraceptive is required for 7 days, and it contains 35 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol with 150 micrograms of noral gestromine, which is the newer generation progesterone, and that is what is released per day. Advantage, once a dose, once a week dosing, avoids first-class metabolism, progestin with minimal androgenicity. Disadvantage is high cost, minor skin reaction, and breakthrough bleeding and nostalgia.
How much is it? 7.5 bubble report.
Can I request people to please mute their mics? I am getting distracted with all the clinical conversation while I'm talking about the contraceptives.
Rita ma'am, please mute yourself. Your voice is coming.
So then we have the patches available by the name of and it releases 30 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol with 125 micrograms of levonorgestrel per day, and once a week for 3 weeks. What is the advantage of the Twala preparation? Now, there is a different kind of a package. It prevents the spillage of the drug from the edges of the patch, and it is more skin friendly. And the compliance is greatly improved. It has completed the phase 3 trials and now almost on the verge of marketing. Then we have Population Council has come out with the gel, 2.3 milligram per day, once a day for 21 days with 7 days free of drug. The combinations could be Nesterone with Estradiol for gel for the females, Nesterone with Testosterone gel for the males. And the advantage is there is no irritation of the skin, there is regular bleeding pattern with hardly any serious adverse effects. Now, we also have metered dose transdermal system, the MDTS system, to administer a preset dose of Nesterone once daily to the skin on the forearm. It is in the phase 1 trial. The advantage is it is fast drying spray and the drug is slowly absorbed over the blood, in the blood over the few hours. Now, coming to the injectables. Now, it is so disturbing to have an injection every day, especially when you are not sick. So, there is a lot of investigation studies going on as to how to decrease the frequency of injections. So, the preparations available are Lunel or Cyclofem and Mezigana. Cyclofem is available in India. Monthly injection, pre-filled syringes are there. 25 milligrams of medroxyprogesterone acetate with 50 milligrams of metin with 5 milligrams of estradiol cyproimate. It's got a very good efficacy of 94% to 99% protection, and it has already completed phase 3 and now it has also come in the market. Others, there is subcutaneous DMPA. There is a lot of focus. In fact, now this has come in the basket of choices in the Ministry of Health. Contraceptive choices in the national program for contraceptives. Other than the DMPA, we have also the LNG butanoate, which is a 4-month injection of use both in men and women. So, a word about the subcutaneous injection of the DMPA, which is available by the name of Cyanopress in India. This is available in the Government of India supply. I don't think it is now freely available, but it is there, and they are going to make it available to all the family planning centers. And it is also available by the name of DepoSubQ. It has the composition the same as that of the intramuscular, that is the depo-medroxyprogesterone acetate. Contains 104 milligrams of MPA in 0.65 ml suspension. There is a reduction by 30% of the total dose of DMPA which is delivered to the woman, and it is administered subcutaneously. It has got a slower and more sustained absorption of progestin, 62% lighter and 25% less volume. It is easily transportable and it is easy to store. So the preparation is available in this form. It is a single-use preparation Uniject system. This is called as the Uniject system. Then we come to the implants. Now we started with the LNG implant many, many years back. It started with Nor plant. Today we are talking about the Uniplant, Elcometrin, Capronor and Cipronor. These basically contain Nesterone and Nomegestrel. Mechanism of action, they inhibit ovulation. The most important one is the Nexplanon. I am talking about this because now it is available in India. Within 8 hours of implantation, 300 nanogram per ml is released in the blood and it is very effective in inhibiting the ovulation. It also thickens the cervical mucus and causes atrophy of the endometrium. Now, this is the forms that are available. See, for it is important to note that it started with 6 rods. Initially, there were 6 capsules in Nor plant. Today, we are talking about Capronor 2, which has only 2 rods, and it is biodegradable. The biggest advantage of Capronor is that it is biodegradable and it does not require removal. Nexplanon is available in India. It is a rigid, semi-rigid plastic rod, 40 by 2 mm in size. It contains 68 milligrams of etanogestrel, releases at the rate of 60 to 70 micrograms per day, followed by 25 to 30 at the end of 3 years. So the insertion is very easy. There is an inserter that is available. You hold it at a certain angle of 30 degrees to the skin and it is inserted. Removal is also quite simple. Other than that, we also have the rings. See, the newer ring, everybody I'm sure is familiar with. Today we are talking about a ring which can be used for many cycles, about 13 cycles. So it is removed over a period of 3 weeks, 1 week off, the way one talks about the oral medication. And the same ring can be used for 13 cycles. So it is awaiting the FDA approval at the present point of time. Then we go on to the intrauterine devices. So again, the first generation was a plastic ring, Lippe's loop, Dalkin shield. In 1960s, they were getting used. Today, we are talking about the fourth generation frameless and flexible intrauterine devices, Gynifix, Mini Gynifix, and Fibroplant. So I am just going to describe what is so special about the fourth generation. In India, we have Mirena available, and also we have the entire property group of devices are available. That is basically the second generation. So the medicated IUDs, there has been a lot of changes taken place even in the direction of the LNG releasing ones by way of reducing the total release of the LNG over a period of time, and also despite the reduction in the release of the LNG, the lifetime use remains almost the same. Now this is 13.5, greatly reduced number of years of use.
Sorry for the interruption, Radhika ma'am. As we have made you a host, so only you can mute rest of the participants. So can you please mute them? So just please mute all ma'am, if you can.
Yeah. Is that okay?
Yes,
now,
thank you.
So you can unmute yourself also, isn't it? Okay. So now, as you can see, there is a reduction in the size also. So we started with property of this size. Today we are talking about the IUDs, which are much smaller in size. So it is almost the size of a paper clip. So reduction in the size of the IUDs, as well as reduction in the total delivery of the hormone. Now, there are today LNG IUS 12, LNG IUS 16. So it is undergoing phase 3 trial. LNG 12 has been already approved in US for use, releases 12 micrograms per day, licensed for 3 years of use, and it is much smaller compared to Mirena. So then the fourth generation IUDs, like I said, are basically the frameless devices. So Gynifix is basically copper 330. It is available by the name of Gynifix 330 because it has the surface area of copper equal to 330 millimeter square. So the copper cylinders are threaded onto a polypropylene suture and it is placed into the uterine cavity. So this is the size of gynefix. Then you have nitinol, which are basically intrauterine ball copper beads, which are strung onto a thread and it is placed inside the uterus. And the best part is that this wire has a memory and it conforms to the shape of the uterus. So it becomes well fitted in the cavity, hence it is very comfortable. Then you have the fibroplant. Now look at this, amazing. It is just one frameless LNG which releases the LNG at the rate of 14 to 20 micrograms per day. And it is a fibrous delivery system which is attached, which has got a hook at the top. So you can just attach it to the uterine wall. Lot of studies have also been taken up, and it has been today well proven, and it is realized that the frameless anchored intrauterine devices are effective in minimizing the displacement as well as expulsion. Biggest problem is in the postpartum uterus. Expulsion rates are very high. So the newer generation copper T devices and the copper containing and medicated devices have been found to be having lesser expulsion rates. So now we come to the emergency contraceptives. I wish to speak about uliprostol acetate, which has been recently introduced by the Government of India, and it has received its approval as emergency recent as July 2020. It is available by the name of Ella-1 over the counter, and it costs about 280 per pack. It is a uliprostol acetate, like we all are familiar with, I'm sure, is a selective progesterone receptor modulator with a primary antiprogesterone activity. It has got a mechanism of action by binding to the progesterone receptors. It stops the pre-ovulatory surge of the LH, thereby preventing ovulation. So it inhibits ovulation by preventing LH surge. It also causes inhibition of the tubal function, thereby desynchronizing the implantation with the development of the ovum with the tubal motility, thereby preventing the implantation. Single dose of 30 mg is effective, taken within 5 days of unprotected intercourse. So that is yet another advantage. So till now, we had always been saying that the IUCDs have the advantage of being used within 5 days of unprotected intercourse because they are protective up to 5 days and the EC pills are till about 72 hours. But here we have this pill which can be used up to 5 days and has been found to be equally efficacious. If vomiting occurs within 3 hours of intake, a second dose is required. And since the metabolism is through the liver, so liver enzyme induces phenytoin and the anti-epileptics are known to affect its efficacy. The hormonal contraception after intake of uliprostol acetate delay initiating by at least 5 days. So once you have taken, once somebody has taken uliprostol acetate, because of the fact that it is a selective progesterone receptor modulator, the effect of the oral hormonal pills is found to be also affected following the use of the OCPs after emergency contraception when UPA has been used. So it is better to delay the intake of hormonal pills by at least 5 days to get the right efficacy and use an alternative method of contraception for that entire cycle. As such, there are no contraindications for the use of UPA as emergency contraceptive, and there is an ongoing research to develop a vaginal ring for with release of UPA. Then we have immunocontraception. I would be just skimming through the slides. Now, a word about the anti-HCG vaccine. This is very important. We have to be very proud in remembering that this was developed in India, and multicentric phase 2 trials were conducted in 1990s. And then it just disappeared from everybody's memory, only to resurface again. And now with the availability of funds, much has been, there is action that has been taken in the direction. So we have anti-sperm vaccines against the functional antigens of the sperms, which are important. These are the enzymes known to be required for metabolism in the sperm. Then there are structural antigens on the surface against which the anti-sperm vaccines have been developed. Then we have the anti-ovum vaccines. These are basically focused on the surface of antigen on the zona pellucida, and this causes an inflammatory reaction in the ovary, which might be indicative of acute ovarian disturbance or long-term immunopathology, still under study. Then we have the anti-conceptives vaccines. placental specific antigen or structural antigens against which the vaccines have been developed. Then pregnancy specific beta 1 glycoprotein again has been found to be very promising, and it has been found to be efficacious to the extent of 80%, and they can manifest it as late abortions. Then also against placental antigen PP5 with minimal side effects. Then you have the male contraceptives. Androgen formulations have now come in the research protocols, testosterone undecanoate and 17-methyl testosterone. Both of them are in the oral formulation, but still under trial. Now, there are other methods of deliveries. We have the transdermal deliveries even for the male contraceptives. We have testosterone patch, gel, and dihydrotestosterone. Gel is also available. Then there are implants, subcutaneous implants, which can be 4-monthly implants. Then there is a phase 2 trial of MENT, which is basically again an implant, and it is at an interval of 6 months. Then you have the buccal system. This has been basically brought out in China. So it is available in the by the brand name of Straint, and it is applied in the buccal mucosa twice a day. And that means it is a daily application twice a day. But however, liver toxicity has been known to be one of the basic problems, still under trial. Then you have the developments with respect to the non-hormonal barrier methods. This is basically the diaphragm. The shape of the diaphragm has been changed. It is easier to remove it. There is a place to put your finger. And the one size which fits all. One doesn't have to measure what would be the right size for anybody. And it has been developed with inputs from multiple countries. So it's very promising. It has been developed by PATH, and today it is available across the counter. Changes have also taken place with respect to the female condom. Now, they have inserted a spermicide tablet which dissolves as soon as it comes in contact with the vaginal mucosa at the tip of the female condom. And there are also the foam-shaped tablets which are there, foam-shaped dots which are there, which help to adhere to the vaginal wall so that the slippage is greatly reduced. Developed by PATH, and today it is available over the counter and has been found to be quite efficacious. Then the intravas device, here the two plugs are used, basically silicone plugs are injected into the vas, and these are considered a permanent form of irreversible contraceptive, which is for the males. But we are very proud to have Rizuke in India. This has been developed by an Indian researcher. It is the reversible inhibition of sperm under guidance. So what is done is basically polymer gel or styrene malic anhydride with DMSO, that is dimethyl sulfoxide, is injected into the lumen of the vas deferens using a non-scalpel technique. Both partially occlude the vas deferens while also deactivate the sperm which are passing through the partially occluded vas deferens, and hence is very successful in preventing fertilization. Now, in India, it is in the terminal stages of phase 3, and one of the best part is that it is reversible and it can be removed by flushing with soda bicarb. And the only side effect is transient painless scrotal swelling. So, in the next coming few years, it might be available for use in the market. Then there are other developments that have also taken place. Now, we have the microchip drug release technology, which is today available. This allows a progesterone releasing chip which can be implanted for up to 16 years. So it is basically an intradermal or a subdermal introduction of this microchip which releases a drug, and the best part is it can be switched on and off with a remote control, causing immediate re or deactivation. And this would expectedly allow a planned pregnancy to take place. Then there are other contraceptive tactics which include stopping the sperm from developing and saving the eggs for later development, special application in people who want to postpone their pregnancies, especially because of malignancies, undergoing chemotherapy, or any such situation. So there are also the COX inhibitors. COX inhibitors 1 and 2 are known to interfere with several essential steps in the female reproduction, also the oocyte maturation and ovulation. And use as emergency contraception is currently undergoing a lot of research. The two drugs which are getting studied are meloxicam and celecoxib. So I would like to conclude by saying that research and development will continue for more acceptable customized contraceptives. But we, most importantly in India, is the unmet need. So we go on talking about the recent advances. Very important for us to know user-friendly recent advances in contraceptives. But it is extremely important for us to address the unmet need. Today, the unmet need continues to remain very high in our country. So anybody who comes, you know, especially our younger colleagues, the people who are now undergraduates and going on to go to become big doctors, especially in the community medicine, kindly remember to go on, you know, creating awareness, you know, have a one-to-one talk. Tell people not to be, you know, scared of using contraceptives. It is more of a trouble to have abortions and having an unwanted pregnancy. Hence, counseling and IEC would remain the backbone of family planning welfare program in our country. So thank you so much for a patient listening.
Thank you very much, Radhika ma'am, for
wonderfully addressing this important topic. Now I would request teachers or teacher, Dr. Nimi Tutani ma'am, our head of department, to say a few words.
Thank you very much, Dr. Radhika, for your wonderful talk. You see, Anna, you have covered right journey of contraceptive right from basic to recent. And it was very useful for us, for our faculty, for our students, for our PGs and all. So thank you very much for your wonderful knowledge. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Questions are welcome from the audience. And I would request Shelly ma'am, if there are any questions she can take up.
Thank you, Dr. Naima. Thank you, Radhika ma'am, for such an elaborate and a crystal clear presentation. And the need of the hour, getting us all updated with the recent advances that are going around. I think, Naima, I'm unmuted.
Please. Yeah, yeah. We can hear you.
Right. Ma'am, there are a few questions. The first one is, still, ma'am, there is a little doubt regarding contraception in Nalipara. What would you suggest?
Now, you know, considering that there is a lot of live-in relationships and people married, unmarried, so many things are there. So I would say that if people who are outside a committed relationship, who really don't, you know, want to consider it. So I think OCPs are one which can be used by both the group of people. But people, there are, you know, especially in our clinical practice, we find there are people who don't want to use hormones. For some reason, you tell them to take some sort of a medication, Malayan, they say hormonal pills, hum lena nahi chahte. So people have to be aware that the failure rates of the barrier contraceptives and, you know, the initial ones, the spermicides and the fertility methods is quite low. So for such people, it would be a good idea to use a dual contraceptive. So it could be like a barrier contraception with a spermicidal jelly. Though it is not as good as an intrauterine contraceptive device or the hormonal pills, but it is still okay. You know, if there are people who are married who just want to space their pregnancy and they are not greatly averse to having a pregnancy. For that kind of a thing, dual contraceptive is also an option. But generally, I would say the oral contraceptive pills are the ideal or the injectables.
What about, ma'am, IUCDs in Nalipara? That's very debatable these days.
Actually, there is a lot of talk going on in that direction. In fact, Skylina, the picture of which I showed, is meant for the Nalipara. It is for the adolescents because the size is reduced. Same is the case with Jedel. So both these can be used, and in the Western countries, they are using it. But if you frankly ask me, I'm not comfortable, you know, inserting this in a Nalipara. And I'm sure all of you will bear with me on
that.
Yes,
ma'am. We have not tried, ma'am.
Yeah, we somehow, you know, when the patient comes and asks, we tend to not, you know, make them go in the direction of an IUCD.
Right.
Frankly, how you counsel is what the uptake is all about.
Yes.
So when you counsel in a certain way, so everybody generally agrees to OCPs. So you can call that as a bias or whatever.
Yes, ma'am. Another injectable that you talked about was LNG butanate. 4 monthly injection. Ma'am, is it available in our country or is it still under research trial?
It's not available in our country. I am not very sure whether it is undergoing research in our country. But it is available, it is undergoing FDA processing. It is not yet available even in US as a, available in the market. So it's not available in our country, surely.
Ma'am, the male implants, are they being marketed? Because I think earlier they were still in phase 3 trials, or in Western world, are they being used?
Western world, yes. In Europe, in some of the countries, it is available, but not in our country.
Okay. Ma'am, another aspect was regarding the Assure. Suddenly, ma'am, it was initially talked about a lot regarding Assure, use of Assure as a contraceptive, and suddenly the incidents and the talk about it has gone down. Any reason for the same?
Assure is basically a coil that you insert in both the ostia. So the point was that it has to be done under hysteroscopic guidance.
Okay.
So to a certain extent, and after that, inserting it in the ostia requires a certain degree of skill. So hysteroscopy and then followed by insertion into the ostia. And number two, it was found to be irreversible. The biggest advantage of Pomeroy and Phillips ring is that the reversibility is there.
Yes.
If it is rightly done, then it is only the scarred area which gets removed, and we do it at a place about 1 centimeter of the tube is removed, and then you do a re-anastomosis. Whereas with Assure, the reversibility is not there. And
so
that
it's not
happens
very popular.
To be, yeah, so that was one of the reasons why it became so, it has gone into the back burner. So people don't like it so much because of the lack of, there are two things, the skill and the lack of reversibility.
Lack of reversibility, and maybe, ma'am, the money, the cost also, hysteroscopic
of
guided,
course.
Yeah, that is also
no.
There,
but
ma'am.
Then, if you were to undertake a laparoscopic procedure or any mini lab for that matter, to that extent, yes, you need an OT setup. So, somebody who has an endoscope or laparocator can also have an hysteroscope. But yes, to that extent, you need more paraphernalia for a hysteroscopic procedure than otherwise.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. These are the questions in my chat box. Dr. Naima, in case you have any more, please.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Somebody wants to ask, Nuva ring is not available these days. So do we have an alternative for it?
Not in our country. Not that I'm aware of. No, but why Nuva ring is not available? I thought there was no problem procuring that. I think the company person can be contacted and they can be asked.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
So thank you all. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure being here. Thank you, Dr. Chutani, Dr. Manisha, Dr. Nirja, Naima. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for inviting me here. And it was
thank
a
you.
Great pleasure interacting with all of you. So
thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ma'am, you are muted. Dr. Nirja is muted. So I will unmute all. How do I unmute all? Ma'am, you can unmute yourself.
I have unmuted.
Can you hear? Can you
hear? Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much, Radhika.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank
wonderful
you so
lecture, wonderful talk. And you have proved yourself once again.
Okay.
Every time I listen to you, I want to learn from you.
That's really nice of you, madam. Thank you for the encouraging words.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr.
It was a wonderful talk, ma'am. We really enjoyed it.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the appreciations. Thank you. Okay, then. Okay, bye.
Bye.
So, next we have quiz-based discussion. We conducted a quiz for 7th semester. It was done by Dr. Khushbu Juneja through Google Form. And I would like to thank again to Manisha ma'am and Pooja Rasugi ma'am for making us all well versed with this Google Form, because that training was conducted for everyone. So at least we got well versed with this Google Form and we are using it. So Khushbu has made a quiz for 7th semester. on the Google formula.
आज के 25 हो गए. कल नहीं आ रही ना. परसों तो मंडे को आएगी ना. मैं फोन कर दूंगी अगर मंडे को आओगे. मंडे को तो क्लास है ना तुम्हारी.
Then a quiz was also conducted by Department of Obs and Gyne for the 9th semester students, which was time bound, and I'm very happy that they did fairly well in it. So among the whole batch, the top performers are who have attained 75% marks are Nitish Kumar, Anshuta Teotia and Kaveri Birla. Those who got 70% marks in this quiz are Swapan Singh, Tabish Kausar Malik, Delphi and Jinesh Jain. Congratulations to all of you. So here we will start now with the discussion on the quiz which you have got. The first question was, 100 couples used a method of contraception for a period of 2 years and have resulted in 24 pregnancies. The Pearl index is, so the answer is 12. Pearl index tells about the failure rate of any contraception and it is calculated by the formula total accidental pregnancies multiplied by 1200 divided by number of patients into months of usage. Here we have to note that if we are considering the cycles of usage, then the multiplication factors becomes 300. So this is a mathematical exercise for you. Now, second question was, Billings method of contraception refers to monitoring basal body temperature, cervical mucus method, rhythm method, coitus interruptus method. So this is cervical mucus method. Billings or cervical mucus method is based on the principle that under the influence of estrogen, cervical mucus becomes thin, watery, profuse.